I'm Reverend Tom Countryman, the pastor of Portage United Methodist Church, and welcome to our worship service for Sunday, May 17th, 2020. We are so glad that you are here with us. For over 10 years, it was my privilege to be able to do a church service every single week at one of our local assisted living facilities, the Heritage House. One of the key things about my Heritage House experience was the fact that I was able to do music for all of those years with Carl Johnson. Everyone calls him Bud. And so here is me and Carl.
Well, God sent an angel down. Yeah, God sent an angel down. Oh, God sent.
Last Sunday, we were talking about the story of Pentecost, and we had gotten the first sort of chunk of it. And now I want to continue by reading to you more of what's referred to as Peter's sermon, or Peter's first sermon there at Pentecost. This is found in Acts chapter 2, beginning now in verse 22. Israelites, listen to these words. Jesus the Nazarene, a man attested to you by God with miracles and wonders and signs, which God performed through him in your midst, as you yourselves surely know. This same man was delivered up by the predetermined plan and foreknowledge of God, nailed to a cross by the hands of godless men, and put him to death. But God has raised him up again, putting an end to the agony of death, since it was impossible for him to be held in death's sway. For as David says, I was always beholding the Lord in my presence, for he is at my right hand, that I might not be shaken. Therefore my heart was glad, my tongue exulted, and my flesh also will abide in hope, because you will not abandon my soul to Hades, nor allow your Holy One to undergo decay. You have made known to me the ways of life, and you will make me full of gladness with your presence. Beloved, I can say to you confidently regarding our ancestor David that he died and was buried, and his tomb is with us today. But because he was a prophet and knew that God had sworn to him with an oath to seat one of his descendants upon his throne, David looked ahead and here was speaking of the resurrection of the Messiah. That in fact the Messiah was neither abandoned to Hades, nor did his flesh suffer decay. It is this Jesus whom God raised up again, to which we are all witnesses. And therefore, having been exalted to the right hand of God, and having received from the Father the promise of the Holy Spirit, he has poured forth this which you both see and hear.
troubles he had some, but was not forgotten. He sat down his love on the wings of a dove, on the wings of a snow-white dove. He sent his pure, sweet love, a sign from above, on the wings of the dove. Went down to the river that day. He was baptized in the usual way, and when it was done, God blessed his son. Love on the wings of a dove, on the wings of a snow-white dove. He sent his pure, sweet love, a sign from sends his pure, sweet love, a sign from above, on the wings of the dove, a sign from above, on the wings of a dove, on the wings of
the works of Luke, so that includes the Gospel according to Luke and the Book of Acts, are written, I don't know, sometime in the 80s, 85 to 90, somewhere in there. And so that's a long time after the events. Jesus died year 30, figure 55 years later for the writing of Luke and Acts. And so Luke is talking about an event that happened a half century before he was writing about it, and an event which he was not present to see. Now, Luke was present as an eyewitness of some of the events in the book of Acts, especially towards the end, because he became an associate of the Apostle Paul, and so he sometimes talks about the things that we did that because he was actually part of that group. But here in the beginning, he wasn't a part of that. Luke is a Gentile convert. He did not come as part of the original Jerusalem church. And so there Luke is writing about this event, which he wasn't present to see. And so the only record he would have of it would be based on the oral traditions that developed over time. Now, a lot of times when scholars like to talk about this stuff, they basically have Luke inventing the whole thing. He just sort of creates this narrative. I'm not sure I agree with that, and I'll tell you why. Luke was an associate of the Apostle Paul. And as an associate of the Apostle Paul, he would know the gospel the way Paul talked about it. In Paul's theology, in the way Paul talks about the ministry of Jesus and the gospel of Jesus, Paul emphasizes the crucifixion of Jesus. Paul likes to make the point that it is the crucifixion which is the saving act of God. So, for example, in the book of Romans, we read these words, "For while we were helpless, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly." A person will hardly give up their life for someone who is righteous, though perhaps for a very good person, someone might dare to die. But God demonstrates such love towards us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Much more now, having been justified by his blood, we shall be saved from the wrath of God through him. So that's sort of characteristic of how Paul looks at the story of Jesus in the gospel of Jesus. A very strong emphasis of the saving work of God through the cross of Jesus Christ. But here, in this original first sermon described for us by Luke, there's none of that. Peter, when he talks about the death of Jesus, he says that the death of Jesus happens according to the explicit foreknowledge and plan of God, but it's the resurrection that he emphasizes. Now, why is that? Well, we have to go back into that immediate context in the year 30. And the context is this. The disciples were coming to understand that Jesus was the Messiah. But they still didn't know what that meant. Like their fellow Israelites, they believed that the Messiah would be maybe a king, or maybe a prophet, or maybe a priest, or maybe some combination of those things, or maybe more than one Messiah. There were a lot of different versions of the messianic hope that was out there. But it never occurred to them that he would be the sacrifice, that he would be the lamb who died, and that he would be the one to rise victorious over the grave. That was like gone to them. And so the death of Jesus was a kind of proof that he could not be Messiah. As it says in the scriptures, "Cursed is the one who is hung upon a tree." I need to say something about that. The Hebrew word for crucifixion, the way they would describe it is they would refer to it as being hung or hung upon a tree. The Greek word for crucifixion means something like to be staked out. The word crucify that you and I are so comfortable using is the one that comes to us from Latin. And so that's the Roman word for it. And so when you talk about someone being cursed who is hung upon a tree, that includes those who are hung by the neck, but also those who are crucified. And so that means that Jesus would be cursed of God. And if that was the case, it would be impossible for him to be the Messiah. And so the very fact of the crucifixion was a denial of any claim that he could be Messiah. And in fact, this is part of what drives Pilate to put above the cross, in multiple languages, by the way, the King of the Jews. Pilate is making the point that Jesus is not the King of the Jews, and that in fact there is no King of the Jews, that the King of the Jews is nothing. The cross proves it. And so the death of Jesus was the thing that repudiated any hope that anyone could possibly have that he was in fact Messiah. Resurrection flips that on its head. His crucifixion seems to negate his messianic identity. His resurrection confirms it. Here's the proof that Jesus is the Messiah. He rose from the dead. So in Peter's first sermon, the crucifixion, the only thing he really tells us about his crucifixion is that it happened, and that the crucifixion was itself expected of God. It was part of God's plan. But that it was the resurrection that was the thing God was after. That's where the emphasis is, that Jesus rises from the dead and overcomes the agony of death. And so the original Christian hope, the original Christian gospel in its earliest possible form, wasn't Jesus died on the cross to save you from your sins. It was Jesus rose from the dead, proving that he is Messiah. Put your faith in the Messiah. Now, here's why I'm telling you this. First, I just find that really interesting. Despite the fact that scholars would want to have Luke sort of inventing this sermon just to work it into his narrative, because he wasn't there anyway, it strikes me as very odd that Luke, if he invented it, didn't use the familiar Pauline way of talking about the death of Jesus that he was so used to. Why not have Peter stand up and say, Jesus died on the cross for your sins. His death was in the, you know, to go into that Lamb of God sacrificial, what we call a substitutionary atonement theology that we come to see developing later. But he doesn't go there. What Luke reports matches the historical setting and matches what would be an expectation of what would we would call primitive Christianity. I don't mean that word as a negative at all. Primitive, the term primitive is often used by scholars to describe the earliest form of a thing before it's sort of fully developed into the shape that we are more familiar with. Early primitive Christianity, they're just figuring this stuff out. They're just coming to understand it. So the thing that's right in their face is the resurrection of Jesus, and the subsequent pouring out of the Spirit. The anointed, when the Messiah pours out the Spirit to anoint with the Spirit those who follow Messiah, and through his resurrection conquers death. Here's why I think that's a valuable thing to just be aware of. The earliest message isn't the same as the later message. They're not conflicting, but the earlier message hasn't grown to include later understandings, a more robust and fulsome appreciation of the significance of the cross. The earliest primitive message of the faith is focused on the resurrection and on the messianic identity of Jesus. That means that within the New Testament, as we read the New Testament, if you know what you're doing and you read it carefully, you can actually see developing theology happening. I don't want to say changing, but it's growing as the texts are being written, as the scripture is being written. I think we see that when we look across the entire Bible. We see this sort of unfolding, growing revelation. We could use a word like progressive revelation or evolving revelation or something. But what it means is that human beings only understand this much, but over time our understanding grows, it deepens. As new pieces of the story come in, they become part of the larger tale. And the result is that we know better. We continue to know better. Last week, if you were watching the service, and if you haven't, go back and watch it, you saw Pastor Doug referring to a slogan from the United Church of Christ. Do not put a period where God has put a comma. God is still speaking. We sometimes have this way of thinking that our current understanding of how things are is, in fact, how it's always been. If you could go back in time and enter a first century Christian community, you wouldn't really recognize much of what they do. You might even wonder if this is really church. They, on the other hand, if they came into one of our experiences, would look around and think we were nuts. Things changed. Early Christians were very strict about the idea of no graven images. But later developments in Christianity shifted that and adopted more the ideas that were familiar to the outside world, so that for us, a picture of Jesus is just a picture. We don't worship it. It's not an idol. It's just a picture. It helps tell a story. But it's a violation of the commandment. At least it would have been understood that way by first century Christians. My point is that it's not fixed. It's changing constantly. Our understanding, our practice, always shifting and moving. When we assume that we are the ones who have it right and that somehow it was always like this, or worse, that it was like this in the first century, but then it got lost and messed up. But now, oh, lucky world, here in the 21st century, we finally got it right again. That's just not true. This is why it's okay that there are so many denominations, and this is why it's okay that we still arguing about and discussing and debating and challenging and working on theology and our understanding of how God works. And this is why it's okay to say, this is what I believe, but I might be wrong. Let us pray. Almighty and gracious God, we long so much to know you. Thank you that you are continuing to speak to us even today. Thank you that your voice is not silenced either in our hearts or in this world, and keep us open to those voices, especially when those voices come to us with a truth that seems at first to challenge how we have always thought it was supposed to be. Lord, this is especially important now for us as we are making a shift, a movement into a new reality. What will be on the other side of our time of social isolation? What will church look like in a year or 2 years? Help us to use this time, this uncertain time, as a time of rich and robust growth. We ask this in your holy name. Amen.
Hi, I'm David Briggs, part of the Administrative Council and Finance Committee here at Portage and Methodist Church. First of all, thank you for all your support over the years. Whenever our church has needed something, such as a new roof, new heating or air conditioning system, we've been able to count on you to help with those repairs and cover those costs. Now it's time to walk across the street and take a look at the parsonage. It's been hosting our pastors for decades and decades. But we've been looking at it, and it's time for some much-needed upgrades and repairs. Some things we need to do, some safety issues have come up with the stairs inside the parsonage, the front door, the garage door. Also in the basement, there's a cracked sewer pipe. Some of the flooring and appliances have not been touched since the 1970s. We want to welcome Pastor Doug with a great place to call home for himself. So we're asking you to help us raise about $22,000 in the next coming months to help finish the parsonage repairs that have been done so far. And we know we can count on you for that help. This, of course, is giving above and beyond what we normally do for our church. But we know we can count on you to help us with that. So we look forward to communicating with you more in the future, in the next few weeks, in regard to how you can help. We look forward to your help. Thank you.
This is my contribution right now for repairing the parsonage. And I want to challenge those of you who are able to match my offering. Let's see if we can't very quickly raise the funds necessary to finish this job. The parsonage is going to be the full-time housing for the next pastor, Pastor Doug. Pastor Doug has been a face that you've come to know pretty well, and so I'm really happy to introduce him to you again. Here's Pastor Doug.
When Peter stood up to address the crowd on Pentecost, he didn't lean only on his own understanding. He reached back into the traditions of his faith, and he referred to a prophet of the Hebrew scriptures. The prophets were famous for their ability to see what was happening in people's lives and to point to the presence of God in their midst. They spoke truth to power, and they proclaimed hope for all the people. So too, Peter was being prophetic and interpreting the presence of the Holy Spirit so that those who had witnessed it could begin to understand. He spoke truth to power, and he proclaimed God's hope for all the people, a hope that was embodied in the Holy Spirit that moved among them. And so this reference was actually an attempt to help people realize this had happened before. This had been promised, and that God was remaining faithful to the promise God had made. We ourselves are moving through a time of transition, one that is made especially difficult by everything else that is happening in our lives right now. And yet we too have received a promise from God not just the general promise of God's covenant, but also the specific promise that we have together as the United Methodist Church. That when a pastor is moved on, a pastor will be received. That when one comes into our community, they are received with grace and love, and that that person brings to us a new way of being and a new way of seeing. And so we have opportunity together, you and I, all of us together, to see the ways that God is moving in our midst, to notice the signs in our lives, and with each other's help and by the power of the Spirit, to see the way that those signs point us to God, so that together we might share in the work God is doing, even here and now. May it be so according to God's will. Amen.
I want to say a big thank you again to those of you who have faithfully continued to support Portage United Methodist Church, and a reminder that you can continue with your support by mailing a check to us at 1804 New Pinery Road in Portage, or you can go to our website and use an online direct giving form that's available to you, or give us a call and get set up for electronic fund transfer. We had one of those great moments at the Heritage House. We learned that Margaret Christianson played the violin. And I said to her, I said to Margaret, I said, well, next Tuesday, come and join us. And she did.
There's a man that is fairer than me, and by faith we can see it above. The Lord Jesus waits over the way to prepare us a dwelling place there in the sweet. We shall be on that beautiful shore in the sweet by and by. We shall be on that beautiful shore. We shall sing on that beautiful shore. The glorious songs of the blessed, and our spirits of sorrow. Set aside for the blessing of rest in the sweet by and by. We shall meet on that beautiful shore in the sweet by and by. We shall meet on that beautiful shore.
And now may the Lord God bless you and keep you. May the face of the Almighty be upon you. And may God grant you peace in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Such love and the blessings that have.